Last time we defined a function from pi 1 of s 1 to the set of integers, taking a path and its class, that's an element of pi 1 of s 1. We lifted this path to a map into R, namely exponential composite that map is equal to the given loop. In doing this, we fixed the starting point to be zero. The end point of this path was the degree of the function, the class f. This function we want to show it now is a homomorphism, right? So this theorem is the function degree from pi 1 of s 1 to z is an isomorphism. 1, 1, onto, and a homomorphism. One of them, one by one, let us prove them. To show that degree is a homomorphism, what we have to do? Let us take two loops, F1 and F2, based at 1. Okay. Let Gi be the loop, Gi be the path is inside R, map into R, such that exponential composite Gi equal to Fi. Those are lifts, such that their starting point is 0. Okay, then G1 is degree of F1 and G2 will be degree of F2, right? So what we have to show is the sum of this is the degree of F1 star F2, the composition of paths inside S1. Okay, so that's what we have to show. So after taking the lifts, what we want to do is take HT to be degree G2 of T plus degree of F1. Add that number. That means you shift it, the G2 will be shifted by a number, namely degree of F1. Okay, by a constant. If you shift a lift by a constant, namely an integer, it will still be a lift of the same function. Namely, exponential of ht is the same thing as exponential of g2, which is f2. The degree of f1 means integer, e raised to 2 pi I times integer is always 1. So it will get multiplied by 1. So it doesn't change. Okay. The degree of F1 is nothing but the end point of G1. So this is what my definition of HT is. Then what I have observed is exponential of H2 is also equal to F2. Therefore, what we get is exponential of G1 star H, okay, will be equal to, you have to take how star is defined. If you apply function f, it will be exponential of g1 star exponential of h. That will be f1 star f2. So I have got a lift of f1 star f2. Instead of taking a lift of f1 star f2, arbitrarily, I have here constructed the lift of f1 star f2 using the lifts of f1 and f2. Okay. All that I have to verify is its starting point is 0. Okay. G1 star H at 0 is the same thing as G1 of 0. But G1 of 0 we know is 0. So this is also satisfied. Therefore, if I take the end point of G1 star H, that must give me the degree of F1 star F2. Okay, degree of F1 star F2 is nothing but the end point of G1 star H. all right, which is H1 now, because G1 star H is, I mean, G1 star, whatever star of a last point is H of that, right? The second part of the loop will come H of 1. But H of 1 is G2 of 1 plus G1 of 1, which is degree of F2 plus degree of F1. The proof that degree is a homomorphism is over. Now we shall prove that its map is an isomorphism. Huh? What happens to the identity loop? Z going to Z. Namely, 0, 1, if you take the as an interval, t goes to e raised to 2 pi I t. What is its lift? At t is equal to 0, it will be just t 1 to t. Therefore, when t equal to 1, degree will be, the endpoint will be 1. That means the degree of the identity loop is 1. Okay. Any homomorphism into Z which assumes the value 1 must be the whole of space. It must be surjective because 1 is a generator. All right. So that proves that the degree map is surjective. Now, finally, suppose degree of F is 0. What does that mean? The lift of F, namely, let us call it G, such that starting point of G is 0, must have the end point also 0. That is the meaning of degree of F is 0. Degree of F is G of 1. So I have a loop. I have a loop here in I, in R. I to R, you have a function. Both the endpoints are 0, right? G1 and G0 are both equal to the same point 0. Need not be 0, any same point. If they are same point, we have seen earlier that such a map is null homotopic as a loop, as a path, path homotopy to as constant path. Yes, you take t times this plus 1 minus t times that. That is the way it works. We have seen that one several times now. We are using that one now. Therefore, there is a homotopy of G to the constant path. Namely, G of Ts is S times G, S times Gt. Because other point is 0. I don't have to add up. Okay. So this is a homotopy of the 0 map with G relative to the endpoints. It is a path homotopy. Okay. If you take exponential of this homotopy, that will give you the homotopy of the constant function 1 with the original function F, the loop F. Okay. Because the original function G is relative homotopy, namely it fixes 0 and 1, exponential of that part will also fix 0 and 1. So this is a path homotopy. Therefore, our F what we have taken, okay, must be the zero element of the group. I mean, additive group, whatever, it is the identity element of the group. Okay. We showed degree of F is 0. The class F must be also the identity element of the group. So this proves that degree being already homomorphism, it is injective now. The kernel of a injective, kernel of a homomorphism is 0 means it is injective. So this proves that the degree map is an isomorphism and completes the computation of pi 1 of S1. Pi 1 of S1 is an infinite cyclic group. So that is the conclusion. Okay, so the first non-trivial group, fundamental group that we have computed is infinite cyclic group. All other things where we have contractible spaces, convex subsets and so on, they were all trivial. Okay, let us give just a few applications here. This will be keep coming again and again. It will have a lot of applications. For that, we have developed other things. Right now, we can give one very important application, namely the Brouwer's fixed point theorem for disks. Two-dimensional disks, not in general. In general will take more time, okay? So the boundary of the disk D2 is not a retract of D2. That's what we will first prove. The boundary of D2 is not a retract of D2. What is the meaning of retract? That there is no function R from D2 to S1 which is identity on S1. S1 is a boundary, right? So this is what we want to prove. There is no map, no continuous function. Okay. No continuous function from the entire disk to the boundary such that is identity on the boundary. Suppose there is such a thing, namely R from D2 to S1, a retraction. Let us denote the inclusion map of the boundary S1 into D2 by I. Okay. Then what we say is retraction means R composite I is the identity of S1. So you can take the base point as 1, 0, the unit. Complex number in S1, okay, on both sides. Then what we get? Identity of the integers is R composite I check. See, identity homomorphism, identity map induces identity homomorphism, right, on the fundamental groups. But identity map is R composite I. So when you take check of that, it is R check composite I check. I check goes from pi 1 of S1 to pi 1 of D2. Then R check goes from pi 1 of D2 to pi 1 of S1 back. Right? And this is identity because R composite I is identity. All right? Now you see that there is a contradiction to the algebraic fact that we have proved that the two end groups here, this one and this one, they are infinite cyclic groups. The middle one is what? This is a disk, so it is convex set. So pi 1 of this one is trivial group. If you write additivity, it is 0. If you write multiplicativity, it is 1, you can write a trivial group. So from a infinite cyclic group, any homomorphism is trivial group, that's trivial. Then whatever you compose back here is a trivial map. So composite will be trivial because it's going through trivial group. But we have identity observed. Identity, this is, remember, this is an infinite cyclic group, pi 1 of it. The identity map is trivial, that is a contradiction. Okay, so look at how a topological fact here, okay, topological hypothesis here converted into algebraic facts and then use that algebraic fact, right, to conclude that whatever we started here is wrong. Okay, because this doesn't fit here. Okay. So you see, these are illustrations of how algebraic topology works. So we will have many such things. So phi 1 of a disk is trivial group is used, but if we didn't know how what this one group is, we won't have been able to tell anything. Okay. If we should know to have this conclusion, we should know that phi 1 of S1 is non-zero group, non-trivial group. That much we should have known. We didn't know that. So you have to compute it. Now we actually know it is infinite cyclic. Okay. All that we used is that it is non-trivial. Okay. Let us see how to get a very good theorem out of this one. Namely, Brouwer's fixed point theorem. Okay, so this corollary was a step towards that one. So Brouwer's fixed point theorem says, for any disk, okay, a continuous, self-continuous map has a fixed point, which you have studied for closed interval 0, 1, or any closed interval AB also, in your real analysis course, by just using intermediate value theorem. But intermediate value theorem will not work in the case of D2 because there is no order here. D2, D3, etc., it won't work. So what is involved here? So that will come out if you look at this kind of proofs. Okay. So how to show that any continuous function from D2 to D2 has a fixed point? This again we go by, suppose there is a map such that fx is never equal to x for any of the axes. X and fx are different points of the disk, right? Any two points inside R2 will determine a unique line, right? So look at that unique line. Inside that line, you can take only the portion between fx and x. So that is a segment. Okay? Line segment fx and x. Now you can give it a direction, namely trace it from fx to x. You can trace it from x to fx, fx to x. So look at trace it from fx to x. Okay, keep extending this, the same line, till you hit the circle, the unit, boundary of the disk. Okay, the boundary of the disk will be hit by whether you go forward or backward in two different points. I wanted the forward point, so from fx to x. That is nearer to x than to fx. Okay, there are two points on this line segment, two points on the circle, intersection of the circle with the entire line. So I want the point which is towards the point x rather than towards point fx. That's all. Let us call that point gx. So I have constructed a function x going to gx out of the function f. The only thing is, only after assuming that f has no fixed points. Okay. The whole thing, you know, geometrically it is easy to see that whatever you have done is a continuous operation, namely g will be also continuous. But you don't have to rely on your geometric intuition here. You can actually prove that g is a continuous function where because f is a continuous function. Okay, let us see how. So first of all, let us have a look at what we have done in this picture. X is not equal to fx, but both of them are in the disk. I am not saying that they are inside the disk, they are in the closed text. They, some of them may be on the boundary also. Doesn't matter. The picture shows both of them are inside. That doesn't mean that they should be on the inside. Okay. Extend that line, okay, towards the fx to x and hit the point g, which is on the boundary. So this function g is expressed in this picture by geometric means. Okay. What I want to say is that this g, you can actually write down a formula for g in terms of x and fx. Okay, finally it is a function of x only, because fx is already a function of x. So let us see how. So a parameterization of this entire line is 1 minus t times x plus t times fx, where t ranges over r. Given any two vectors u and v, t times this plus 1 minus t times that gives you the entire line passing through the endpoints of these vectors u and v, right? So that is the vector algebra. So t times 1 minus t times x, t times x. This is the line segment. This is the entire line. But I don't want the entire line. I want what? Gx, okay, is 1 minus t naught times x plus t naught times fx, where t naught is the root of the equation, quadratic equation, in terms of t. What is that equation? The norm of this must be equal to 1 because it is on the circle. The norm of this vector is nothing but, you say, you can rewrite this whole thing, t square, t naught square, norm v square plus twice t naught v dot x plus x norm of x square minus 1. Okay. So that is the solution of this. When t equal t naught, you get this one. So this is the equation. It's a quadratic equation. Norm v is given. Okay. What is norm v? Namely fx here. Okay. Plus 2 times t, v is fx dot x. X is another vector. Plus norm of x square minus 1 equal to 0. Okay. So I have put, what is this v? V is the vector fx minus x. Okay. You check what we have done here. 1 minus t times x plus t times fx can be written as t naught times fx minus x. That is why I have taken that. You rewrite the t times fx minus x as v. Then the computation of this norm is easy. Okay. So solutions of a quadratic equation wherein the coefficients are functions of x automatically will be what? Smooth functions. If the coefficients are smooth functions. If they are continuous, the solutions will be also continuous because we can give it them by formula. B naught plus minus square root of b square minus 4ac divided by 2a, whatever, right? That's what we have to do. So since x squared minus 1 is negative or non-negative because x is inside the circle, right? In the disk of the radius 1. It follows that the discriminant of this quadratic equation is non-negative and identically zero if and only if this x square is equal to 1, this is 0. Okay. And v dot x is also 0. B square minus 4ac, so that is 0 means both of them must be 0. But then what happens is modulus of fx square will be equal to modulus of x square plus v square. V is fx minus x. Okay. If v is perpendicular to x, then the norm of fx square will be norm of x square plus norm of v square. Right? Norm of x square plus norm of v square will be greater than 1, which is absurd, because this whole thing is less than 1. Okay, so that will not happen. Therefore, the discriminant is strictly positive, and hence the two roots are continuous. See, whenever equality equal to 0, there will be a problem about discontinuity of functions are continuous or discontinuous. And strictly positive, you can take the square root, it will be a positive function, it will be a continuous function. Right? So I have given you full justice why the roots of this polynomial of this quadratic equation are continuous functions of the variable x here. The discriminant is strictly positive, and hence the two roots are continuous. In particular, the t naught, which is a solution of the equation, is a continuous function of the variable x. It depends upon x. We are writing it as a constant, but as x changes, the point also g will also change. Okay, this g is nothing but, g is nothing but 1 minus t naught times x plus t times fx. Okay, finally. So g is continuous function. Okay, now you can verify either by using the quadratic equation or by directly using the picture. If x is already on the circle, fx may be anywhere. What happens to the line segment? When you extend it, x itself is a point on the circle. Beyond that, it will go away. So this is the intersection, is gx will be equal to x. Gx is equal to x if and only if x is on the circle. Okay. Okay, I have given a point g, I have given function g, which is identity on the circle, and it's a continuous function from the entire disk to circle. G takes values in the circle. Its domain is the entire disk, and on the circle, it's identity. And that is a contradiction to the first corollary here. There is no such function. There is no retract of A2. So why we get a contradiction? We started with the assumption. That assumption must be wrong. Fx is not equal to x for any x. What is the conclusion? There must be a point x such that fx is equal to x. Okay? So that is the conclusion. Next time, we will prove another method to compute the fundamental groups. Both these methods will be later on strengthened far beyond what you see in the beginning in the course later on. Okay? So next time, we will prove what is called as Wendt-Campan's theorem, a starting very simple version of that. There are many other versions later on. All right? Yeah. Thank you.